Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Guillermo Ferreira, Associate Dean for the College of Science, and I'm here to welcome all of you to the Porcelli Lecture Series for this year, and also to welcome Maria Chudnovsky and thanking her for coming to talk to us.
Thank you.
For your third visit to LSU, I heard. Dean Peterson couldn't be here, so she sends her regards and greetings, and she is meeting with another department. I mean, she's doing the departmental visits this week. I mean, she was meeting with the math department last week, and today it was another department in the college that she's meeting with. I'm very pleased to have Maria visiting LSU. We sent her.
The stage is amplified.
On the stage?
Yes.
Okay. Right, so they're putting more distance between us. Okay, so we're very pleased to welcome her to LSU. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of the lecture series. The lecture series is named after Professor Pasquale Porcelli, who was a named boy professor in 1965 here at LSU. He may have been the first boy professor in the math department, I think. He worked in the area of analytic functions, and the endowment to support this lecture series and some scholarships was set up by his family after his untimely death in 1972. Dr. Porcelli was famous not only for his papers, I mean, which appear in the famous journals of the time, I mean, the Bulletin, the Proceedings of the American Mathematical Society, the Duke Math Journal, the Studia Mathematica, and so on. But also, he was famous for preparing excellent PhD students. Two of those students became Sloan Fellows after they graduated from LSU. I looked at the genealogical project, and he produced 18 PhD students. And he has 132 descendants. I mean, that's quite a feast. He joined LSU after he had, one interesting thing, he graduated from high school in 1948, and 4 years later he got a PhD from UT Austin. He was for a few years at the Illinois Institute of Technology, and then he joined LSU until he passed away in 1972. This lecture series, there have been over 20 Porcelli lecturers coming to LSU since 1980. All of these are very distinguished mathematicians, and today's lecture is no different. I'm very pleased that you will be our Porcelli lecturer. Professor Chudnovsky received her PhD from Princeton, and after a few years at Columbia, she was called back by Princeton. Her work in graph theory has received numerous accolades and awards. She has been a Clay Research Fellow, a MacArthur Foundation Fellow. She has been an invited speaker to the International Congress of Mathematicians in Kyoto. And she received the Fulkerson Prize with some of her colleagues. I think we are going to hear about that even in the first talk today. The title of Professor Chudnovsky's first Porcelli lecture is Perfection and Beyond. What a title. There will be two additional talks tomorrow, in the morning one, and in the afternoon the other one, in this same location. Okay? Professor Chudnovsky.
very much for having me, and thank you for the wonderful introduction. I'll do my best. There's no pressure. So this is Perfection Beyond, and this talk is sort of a summary of everything, or a lot of the work I've done in my life. So what I'll do tomorrow is expand on some parts of this talk, but this is kind of an introduction to everything. All right, so I'm a graph theorist. I work on graphs, and graphs have vertices and edges, and some vertices are adjacent by an edge, some vertices are not adjacent by an edge, and there are two graph parameters I'm interested in, many people are interested in. One of them is the chromatic number of the graph. So what that means is you want to assign colors to the vertices, and the rule is that if two vertices are adjacent, they have to get different colors, and then you want to do it with as few colors as possible. So the smallest number of colors you need in order to be able to color your graph is the chromatic number. And then there's a related parameter, which is a clique number. And so what that means is a clique in a graph is a set of pairwise adjacent vertices. And then the clique number is the size of the biggest clique. And now if you think about it for about 10 seconds, you'll notice that the chromatic number is always at least the clique number, because if you have a clique, you have to color every vertex in that clique with a different color. All right, so what do you do when there are two nice parameters and you have an inequality between them, but it's easy? Well, you ask, what are the cases of equality? And so it turns out this is actually not a bad question, because there are many nice families of graphs where the clique number and the chromatic number are the same. So I'm going to give some examples, but this is by no means an exhaustive list. So for example, you have bipartite graphs. What's a bipartite graph? That means you can partition the vertices into two parts, and all the edges go between the parts. So the chromatic number is 2, right? That's exactly what it means to be bipartite. You color this color 1 and that color 2, and the clique number is also 2. Complements of bipartite graphs. So let's not dwell on the name right now, but what it means is you take two cliques, right? Remember, a clique is a set of vertices with all the edges inside. So you have two cliques, and then you put some edges between them, some arbitrary edges. And again, it's true that the clique number and the chromatic number are the same. It's harder to see. It's in fact a theorem of Koenig, but it's nevertheless true. Comparability graphs, for example, take a partially ordered set and make a graph whose vertices are the elements of the set, and two vertices are adjacent if the two corresponding elements are comparable. So then, what's the chromatic number? It's covering the partially ordered set by antichains, how many antichains you need. What's a clique number? It's the length of the longest chain. So again, they're the same. All right, then you can continue. There are many nice graph classes where chi and omega are the same. But here's an example we don't like quite as much. So take your favorite graph on at most 99 vertices, and take disjoint unions with K100, which means just draw a copy of, draw a clique of size 100 right next to it. There's no edges. So then, what's the clique number? Well, the clique number is 100. There is a clique of size 100 sitting here. What's the chromatic number? The chromatic number is also 100, right? Color everybody here, color 1 to 100, and color this guy somehow, colors 1 to 99. So the clique number and the chromatic number are the same, but somehow you didn't really learn anything interesting about the graph, right? All you know is that there's a separate component sitting there and sort of messing with your reality. It's a huge clique and you can't see it. And what's going on here, you don't know. So what you'd like is a better question than when is there equality. What you want is to ask a question where, in the nice instances, the answer will still be yes. But in this instance, somehow the answer will be yes and no, depending on what's going on in this graph. And there is such a question. So Claude Berge came up with a definition that did exactly that. He said, the graph is perfect if the clique number and the chromatic number are the same, but also we want it preserved under vertex deletion. So however it differs, it's still true that the clique number and the chromatic number are the same. Now let me say this more rigorously and also throw in a definition. So an induced subgraph of a graph is what you get by deleting some vertices, and then if you delete a vertex, you must delete all the edges instant with it, but that's the only operation you're allowed to do. So maybe better known operation in graph theory is taking subgraphs, which is delete some vertices, delete some edges. That's not what we're doing. If you didn't delete two ends of an edge, you're not allowed to delete the edge. So it's to an example, I start with this graph. This is a new subgraph of that, because to get this from that, what you do is delete this vertex, and then you're forced to delete all the edges that have this vertex as their end. This is not an induced subgraph of that, because to get this from that, what you need to do is delete this edge and delete this edge, but you're not allowed to do that, right? That's not an allowed operation. And so then to say Berger's definition more precisely, a graph is perfect if the Klick number and the chromatic number are the same for all induced subgraphs. And so then what happens? Well, in all these cases, if you take induced subgraphs, you stay in the family, right? If you had a backpack graph and you deleted some vertices, you still have a backpack graph. If you have a comparability graph and you deleted some vertices, it's still a comparability graph. It's just you start with a smaller coset. And so the Klick number and the chromatic number are the same for all induced subgraphs. But what happens here is that I don't know. After I deleted, you know, all of these 100 vertices, I don't know what happens there. I don't know the Klick number and the chromatic number are the same or different. And so somehow something will happen. All right, so Berger defined these perfect graphs, and it turns out it's a really nice class of graphs, right? You come up with some concept. How do you know if it's a good concept? Well, one sort of test is, I defined it in this context. Is it any good in that context? Is there anything good about it except for the precise purpose that I defined it for? And it turns out perfect graphs sort of have these surprising properties. They're good in unexpected ways. So the first thing that's good about them is what we already said. They generalize many theorems in graph theory that we already know, right? There were many theorems that said, for every graph in this class, the Klick number and the chromatic number are the same. Now we can rephrase it and say, every graph in this class is perfect. But here is something new and unexpected. So there are problems that are NP-complete on general graphs. But if you are promised that the input is polynomial, then suddenly you can solve this problem efficiently. So such problems, for example, are finding the biggest click in the graph. It's very hard in a general graph. It's not complete in a general graph. But in a perfect graph, you can solve it in polynomial time. Maximum stable set. So a stable set is a set of vertices with no edges between them. Again, not complete in general polynomial perfect graphs. Finding the best color, optimal color. And then here's another thing that sort of connects this topic of perfect graphs to combinatorial optimization. So think about the following polytope. I want to look at characteristic vectors of cliques in the graph. And now I want to think about which vectors have dot product at most one with those. So one thing that you get is characteristic vectors of stable sets, right? The clique in a stable set meet at most one point, and so the dot product of characteristic vector of this and a characteristic vector of that is at most one. Then you can take convex combinations of characteristic vectors of stable sets. But in general graphs, there's more. In perfect graphs, this is it. So if you look at the polytope, and this is terrible notation, I haven't changed it. If you look at the polytope consisting of vectors that give dot product at most one with characteristic vectors of cliques, its extreme points are just characteristic vectors of stable sets. So all you get is convex combinations of stable sets. All right, so the point of this slide is to say perfect graphs are nice. If you already believe that, all right, so now perfect graphs are nice, which graphs are not perfect, right? Maybe all graphs are perfect, that would be wonderful, but of course it's not true. So here are some examples of graphs that are not perfect. So think about this graph. This is called C7. This is a cycle on 7 vertices. So in general, you can think of 2n plus 1 vertices on a circle, consecutive points adjacent, non-consecutive, non-adjacent, and then you'll get C2n plus 1. So I claim all these graphs are not perfect, because what's the Klick number? Well, the cliques are just the consecutive points, so the Klick number is 2. What's the chromatic number? Well, it's not 2, because if you take an odd number of points and you try to color them, so you go 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, and then you're stuck in 3. So the chromatic number is 3. So this is an infinite family, very simple, but infinite family of graphs, all of which are not perfect. And you have to be a little bit careful. So we said odd cycles, but you shouldn't take the odd cycle of length 3. Because what happens if you just have 3 vertices? Well, it's true that the chromatic number is 3. But it's not true that the Klick number is 2. Because the first thing I said is not true. Right? all three of those make a clique. It's not true that it's just the consecutive pairs that make clicks. but what's written here is correct. So here is another infinite family, and what this is, it's called complements of odd cycles. So what you do is you take two n plus one vertices and you put them in a circle, and you make consecutive points non-adjacent and non-consecutive points adjacent. And I claim the clique number and the chromatic number again are different because, so what's a clique number? You can't have two consecutive points in a clique. So you have to go one, two, one, two, one, two, sorry. So if you want to build a clique, you go yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, no. So the biggest clique has size n. And what's a chromatic number? You have two n plus one points, and you want to color them, but each color class can only have at most two vertices, right? Only stable sets are consecutive pairs. So you're trying to cover two n plus one vertices with subsets of size at most two, so you need n plus one subsets. So the chromatic number is at least n plus one. So that's another infinite family of graphs that are not perfect. And it turned out that in some sense, this is old. So Bersh made two conjectures about perfect graphs, both of which by now have been proved. The first one is a weak perfect graph conjecture that says a graph is perfect if and only if its complement is perfect. And let me tell you what the complement of a graph is. So you start with a graph, and now you reverse all the adjacencies. If two vertices were adjacent, you make them non-adjacent. If two vertices were non-adjacent, you make them adjacent. What you get after that is the complement. So the first conjecture, which is now a theorem proved by Lovas, is that the graph is perfect if and only if reversing all the adjacencies, you get another perfect graph. Which is, I mean, I don't know, to me it's very surprising. I mean, I've worked a lot on perfect graphs. It's still it's just a standalone statement. It sounds very surprising to me. Why would it be? But then there's the second conjecture, which is now a theorem, which sort of sheds light on it. It explains why this is not a completely crazy idea. So what this says is that the only way for a graph not to be perfect is to contain a new subgraph, one of these or one of those. Right? The only a graph is perfect if and only no induced subgraph is one of these, and no induced subgraph is one of those. Well, if you believe that, then of course it's invariant and taking complements, because the two things we forbid are complements of each other. So, yeah. So obviously it's invariant and taking complements. So this is the first statement is the weak perfect graph theorem, first conjecture that theorem. Second statement is the strong perfect graph theorem, and this is joint work with Neil Robertson, Paul Simmer, and Robin Thomas. And well, the date here is 2006, but this is, it depends a little bit what you count. We proved it in 2003. Long process between then and when it's actually published. So I say 2006. All right, so there's two theorems. So I want to talk a little bit about the proof of this. When I first came to this room, I was so excited that I can see this light right in front of my eyes, and I don't need to stand like this all the time. But you can probably see I'm standing like this all the time. It's absolutely not working. Maybe by the end of my third lecture, I'll regain my posture. All right, so. So what I want to talk about first is a little bit about the proof of the strong perfect graph theorem. And so what do we need to prove? We need to prove that not containing those in new subgraphs is the same as being perfect. Well, one direction is clear. If the graph is perfect, then chi and omega are the same for all induced subgraphs. And so you can't contain any of these guys where chi and omega are not the same. So what you need to understand is what graphs, you need to be able to say something about graphs that don't contain these or those. You need in particular to prove that they're all perfect. So let's have a definition. A graph is Bersh if it's a candidate for being perfect. It doesn't contain any odd cycles, any induced odd cycles, and doesn't contain any complements of induced odd cycles. Well, that's at least fun. So then we need to prove that Bersh and Bersh is the same, and we already said perfect implies Bersh is clear. So now, how would you go about proving that Bersh implies perfect? So there are sort of two schools of thoughts, at least as far as I can see it. And in the end, the proof is 70% one and 30% the other. So one idea was, let's try and prove properties of a minimal counterexample. Let's prove as much as we can about a minimal Bersh graph which is not perfect. And hopefully we'll be able to prove so much about it that that in the end will prove two things that contradict each other, so there's no contraxemplant. And then the second approach was what it says here. Let's forget for a minute that actually we're after the Sturmkopf graph theorem, and let's just try and understand what Berggrafs look like. And if we can really get a structure theorem, if we can really describe all Berggrafs, well, then you can go and check any property you're interested in. In particular, you can look at your construction and check if every graph constructed this way is perfect. So in the end, we weren't quite successful in completing this task, even though that's what it says here. But the proof is in this spirit until it doesn't work anymore, and then we quickly switch to proving properties of the minimal contraxemplant. And so let me describe in more detail what I mean. So here's a triple of theorem, and any triple like that would imply the Sturmkopf graph theorem. So let's see what this triple says. The first theorem is every Berggraf is either basic or admits a useful decomposition. The second theorem is all basic graphs are perfect. The third theorem is if you look at the smallest Berggraf that's not perfect, then it cannot admit a useful decomposition. So there's no details here. All hidden. Suppose I prove something like this, so let's just quickly see this would apply to the Sturmkopf graph conjecture. Well, suppose the Sturmkopf graph conjecture is false, and there is a Berggraf that's not perfect. Let's look at that. And let's look at one with as few vertices as possible. Well, it's a Berggraf, so I can apply theorem 1 to it. Either it's basic or it admits useful decomposition. If it's basic, I get a contradiction to theorem 2, because theorem 2 says all basic graphs are perfect. If it's if it admits useful decomposition, then I really get a contradiction to theorem 3, because theorem 3 says exactly that can happen. So next, theorem 3 is where sort of we fall short of in some sense of really proving a structure theorem for all Berggrafs, right? Because this useful decomposition is the only thing I require from them is that they satisfy theorem 3. I don't require from them any kind of property that would say, you can decompose a graph like this, but then you can take two pieces and glue them together, or something in that spirit, which would really give you a structure theorem for the class of Berggrafs. So that's missing. The only thing we ask our decompositions to satisfy is theorem 3. All right, so this is the triple. And now I want to do even more details than this. So I'm going to sort of fill this with content. What's left? What do I need to do to fill this with content? I need to tell you what basic graphs are, and I need to tell you what the decompositions are. And then I can quote theorems. All right, so there are five classes of basic graphs. When we first proved this theorem, I was proudly telling about it to a classmate of mine. And he said, this can't be true. And I said, how do you know? You do algebra. And he said, well, you said it's complement invariant, but there are five basic classes. It has to be an even number, because everything has to happen also in the complement. But in fact, the fifth class is self-complementary. So the theorem is still true. Let me explain what this says. So we have bipartite graphs, which I already mentioned. That just means it's two sets with no edges within them, and then some edges in between. As this schematic picture so clearly illustrates. So then we have complement bipartite graphs, and now actually I have a slide for that. So let me tell you again what the complement of the graph is, now in written form. So you start with a graph, and now you build another graph with the same vertex set, and then if two vertices are adjacent in the complement, if and only if they're non-adjacent in the graph you start with. Complement of the graph is. So then you have complements of bipartite graphs. So if you take a complement of a graph like this, what you get is this becomes a clique, this becomes a clique, and then in between the non-edges become edges, and the edges become non-edges. So you get this picture. So then we have line graphs of bipartite graphs. So again, I have an explanation here. So if you start with a graph, its line graph is just another graph that records the intersection pattern of edges. So the vertices of the line graph are the edges of the graph you started with, and two vertices are adjacent if the two edges share net. And then, this says, you start with a backpack graph and you take its line graph, and everything you can get like that is another basic class. Then the next one is complements of line graphs of backpack graphs. So start with a backpack graph, you take its line graph, and then you take its complement, and that's another basic class. And then the last class, let me not describe it to you, it's not so crucial, but the only thing I'll say is that it's self-complementary. All right, so these are the five basic classes. And now let me tell you about the decompositions. So there are two kinds of decompositions. There's something called a skew partition. So a graph admits a skew partition if you can partition the vertices into four non-empty parts, A, B, C, and D. And the rule is, if you delete A union B, the graph becomes disconnected, which means there are no edges from C to D. And if you delete C union D, the complement becomes disconnected, which means everybody in A is adjacent to everybody in B. So that's the only rule. This was introduced by Patrick Fettel, and this is a very nice decomposition from the point of view of perfect graphs because it's self-complementary, right? If your graph admits it, then also its complement admits it. And this is kind of what you want, right, when you're working on a class of graphs closed under taking complements. It's a good test whether what you're doing is sensible. All right, so that's skew partitions. And in fact, maybe I'll say already that in the end, we had to restrict our attention to a special class of skew partitions. So I'm not going to go into details of that, but in fact, we use a slightly more restricted decomposition than skew partitions. All right, so and then the second decomposition is something called a two-join. So what's a two-join? It's a partition of the graph into two parts, one called top, not called bottom. And then the rule is that the edges from top to bottom are somehow very well structured, very tightly structured. So the bottom consists, the top consists of three sets, A1, B1, and C1, and the bottom consists of three sets, A2, B2, and C2. And everybody in A1 is adjacent to everybody in A2, everybody in B1 is adjacent to everybody in B2, and there are no other edges from top to bottom. So if you were to write down an adjacency matrix of top and bottom, it would have rank 2. So, all right, so this is seemingly not as nice as that, because this is not at all invariant undertaking complement. So you have to say this could happen in the graph or this could happen in the complement. But a sense in which this is better is that this somehow has a lot more structure. You can, if you look at the partition top versus bottom, then really it's very easy to describe what's going on between them. Here, no matter how you partition, there's still a lot of degrees of freedom, right? Like this this wiggly edges, that's where I have a degree of freedom, that's where I don't care what the edges are. And no matter how you partition this, you still have a wiggly edge crossing your partition. So that turns out as a big thing. Well, here there is a partition with no wiggly edges crossing. Partition edge. Okay, so let's keep going. So now I can tell you theorem one, the decomposition theorem, that says every branch graph is either basic or basic decomposition. So here it is. Every branch graph is either its complement is bipartite, or either its complement is the line graph of a bipartite graph, or it's a double split graph, or it admits a balanced skew partition, balanced being that slight restriction I was talking about. Or the graph for its complement admits a two-join, or the graph admits something called a homogeneous pair, which in fact you don't need, so I'm not going to spend time describing it. But I like to mention it because proving that you don't need this was my PhD thesis. It's dear to my heart. All right, so this is theorem one, and then theorems two and three were. A lot of it was not. So theorem two is that these graphs are all perfect. One and two, that was known as the theorem of Koenig. Three, it was our theorem, but it's not hard. So with balanced skew partitions, the reason we have to say balanced instead of just general skew partition is exactly because we need to prove that this decomposition is useful. This decomposition cannot occur in a minimal counterexample to the strong perfect graph theorem or conjecture. And we couldn't do it. It was conjectured that skew partitions are useful in this sense. But it's called Hlatow's Q-partition conjecture. But we couldn't prove it. The only thing we could prove was that Malan's Q-partitions had this property until quite a way into the proof. Then, luckily, in this theorem, it was enough to just use balanced Q-partitions. This was hard. And then the fact that two joints are useful, that was also known. That was a theorem of Korngerth and Cunningham. That was fine. All right, so that's that. And now let me just say a little bit about the proof. So how do you prove a theorem with eight outcomes? What's the hardship in proving a theorem with eight outcomes? The problem is you don't know which way to push. Here's your graph, and you don't know if you're trying to prove that it's a Bartek graph or it's a complement of the Bartek graph. So you don't know if you need to prove that these two roots are adjacent or they're non-adjacent. So it would be nice to somehow break your world into subcases, so that in each subcase you would know what you're proving. You wouldn't have eight outcomes, you would have as few as possible, ideally one, at least not eight. And that's basically how the proof works. We, at every stage, we assume that we're looking at a Bersh graph that contains some subgraph some induced subgraph that prevents it from satisfying some of the outcomes. And then you use this subgraph to kind of understand the structure of what's left. You use this subgraph to see how the rest of the vertices attach and prove various theorems about what else is going on in the graph. And then hopefully you prove that either the graph is basic or there is a composition. Now you move on, but now you're in a more restricted situation, because now you can assume that the thing you assumed was present in the first stage is no longer present. So you keep proving sort of easier and easier theorems, because you keep having more and more things excluded. So this is sort of very high-level outline of the proof, and I thought I would show you one example of a strategy just to make it a little bit less unclear. So this is the first theorem in this field that we ever proved. This is not, in fact, if you look at the proof of the strong graph theorem, this is somewhere in the middle. This is not the first theorem we used, but this is the first theorem we proved. So let me tell it to you. So what this says is, if you have a Bersh graph and it contains this induced subgraph, and this is just an honest graph on eight vertices, right? So you have a Bersh graph, contains this subgraph on eight, this induced subgraph on eight vertices. And then the theorem is your big graph admits a balanced Q-partition. Now, you can see that this guy admits a balanced Q-partition. I don't know if you can see the colors from where you are, but so this vertex is adjacent to those four, right? The green is adjacent to the red, and then the purple is non-adjacent to the yellow. And that's what this Q-partition is. These two are complete to each other, these two are anti-complete to each other. And the theorem is that you can give a rule for every other vertex of the graph, whether it should go into the green set, or the red set, or the purple set, or the yellow set. And if you follow those rules, what you'll get is a skew partition of the whole graph. So this is kind of surprising. Why should this little eight-vertex graph have such amazing power? The theorem is that it does, and I can explain a little bit of it, and then the rest is magic. So if you look at this graph, the striking property that it has is that it's in none of the five basic classes. Like, for example, it contains a triangle, so it can't be bipartite. It contains a stable set of size 3, so it's not complement of bipartite. It contains what's called a claw, with three pairwise non-adjacent neighbors. So it can be a line graph, and you can continue checking. So it's in none of the basic classes, and so anything that contains it cannot be in any of the basic classes. So now, remember, I'm trying to prove this, but if you contain that eight-vertex subgraph, those outcomes are impossible. So I'm just left with outcomes 4 and 5. And that's where I can't explain this anymore. I don't know why you don't need two joints. I don't know why you can prove that the skew partition extends. Except for the proof, I don't have an explanation for it. All right. So this was it. So just to remind you, there's a triple of theorems that would prove the strong graph theorem for you. And now what I did so far was show you one example of such a tree, right? We had one theorem one and one theorem two and three came along, but in fact, you know, you can come up with a, or if you can come up with another triple like that, that will give you another proof of the strong graph graph theorem and maybe simple. And in fact, that did happen in about 2006, maybe. So we introduced, so this is now joint work with Paul Seymour. We introduced two more useful decompositions into the mix. So one of them is called an even pair, and what that means is two non-adjacent vertices, so that every induced path between them has an even number of edges. And this was, you know, this was a decomposition that had been known for a long time, and it was clear that it's probably useful for thinking about perfect graphs, but somehow in the first version of theorem one, we didn't use it, and then turned out we could. And then the second decomposition is, as far as I know, something that we invented, but it's not anything deep, maybe somebody else invented it also. It's called the dominant pair. It's two non-adjacent vertices, so that every other vertex is adjacent to at least one. And you can prove that. So now you want a smallest counterexample with as many edges, so fewest number of vertices and biggest number of edges. And now you have a counterexample optimized under this, and that cannot admit the dominant pair. And so anyway, the details are not exactly important, but what is important is that we have this new theorem, which is much better. It says every pair graph is either basic in the same sense as before, or it admits balanced superposition, or its complement admits a two join, or it admits an even pair, or it admits a dominant pair. So the theorem got harder, but on the plus side, now if somebody is about to ask why this doesn't say G or its complement admits an even pair, I don't know. I think it might be a typo. But anyways, something like that. Right, so the theorem got harder, but the proof got easier. So the proof used to be 150 pages, and the proof of this is just 100 pages. But it's a bigger savings than it seems, because the last third of the original proof was really terrible. And now it's gone. So sort of in length, we gained 30%, but in clarity, I think we gained a lot more. All right, so that's that. So what else is there about perfect graphs? Well, there was a related question, somewhat related question. Can you test if a graph is perfect, right? We said one of the nice things about perfect graphs is that you can solve various algorithmic problems on them more efficiently than on general graphs. But it would be nice to sort of make that robust, right? That I wouldn't require that you give me a perfect graph. You give me any graph, and I test if it's perfect, and now if it is, I go and apply my cleverness, and if it isn't, I say, sorry, there's nothing I can do. So can you test in polynomial time? Can you test efficiently if a graph is perfect? And that was also open, and now it's not open anymore. You can. It takes time n to the ninth, not great at polynomial. And it's, so we originally thought, and so this is joint work with this group, and we originally thought that we can use our theorem one, right? We have a theorem that says every batch graph is either a basic or admits a decomposition, so you know, it's clear what to do with it algorithmically. Test if a graph is basic, test if it admits a decomposition, if it does, break it apart, see if the parts are if the parts are perfect, and now prove a theorem that says that's enough, now your graph is perfect. But we can't, we don't know how to prove a theorem. So it was, you know, our first attempt was to try and use this decomposition theorem to get a recognition algorithm, but that was just a complete failure. And then at some point we had an algorithm that used the decomposition theorem a little bit, and then it turned out it didn't hit it at all. So this algorithm is completely independent of the proof of the strong perfect graph conjecture, except in one sense that what it actually tests for is whether your input is better. So if you don't know the strong perfect graph theorem, but what you care about is whether a graph is perfect, then this doesn't happen. But that's not a problem anymore, because we do know the strong perfect graph theorem. But the proof, otherwise, is completely independent. And in fact, much easier. It's 20 pages or so. All right. So now, moving on to things that are still open, what about finding an optimal color? So there is an algorithm, right? That was one of the first things I said, that if you give me perfect graphs, we can efficiently find an optimal coloring. But what you do is you use combinatorial optimization. You define a semi-definite program, and then you use, you know, the ellipsoid method and all sorts of heavy machinery to solve it. And then that gives you, well, and then there's another little combinatorial bit that's been done by Lovett, Gorch, and Scriver, and then you get a color. But what if I didn't want to do that? What if I wanted a combinatorial algorithm, or a non-geometric algorithm, or maybe to make it completely precise, an algorithm that doesn't use division? Right? I mean, but really, sort of, I want, you know, something that a graph theorist can understand. So that's open. That we don't know how to do, and it's something that we're working on. So again, one possible idea is we have a decomposition theorem. Use it. You know, there are known algorithms to color basic graphs. Now, if your graph admits a decomposition, break it apart, find colorings of the two parts, and find a way to put the two colorings together. But that's hard. We don't know how to do it. And in fact, so remember, there are basically two decompositions. There's two joints and there's balanced Q partitions. And in some sense, balanced Q partitions are more elegant, but in fact, they're a problem. We don't know how to sort of follow through with that route if your graph admits a balanced Q partition. So then there are various ideas, you know, maybe try and not use all of them. So I'll talk about that more either tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon. But there's one sort of interesting step that's already been done. So if I give you a graph that doesn't have balanced two partitions, so I know that either it's basic or it admits a two-join or a two-join incomplete, then it turns out you can color. There is a polynomial time algorithm to color this graph, and you know, without using division, just in terms of graph theory. So just to sort of make it a little bit clearer. So I give you a graph that doesn't need a skew partition, and there has been a way known to handle two joints for coloring for quite a while. So then it seems that we are done, because the graph needs a two joints, so break it apart, color the parts, put them together. But there's a problem with it, because when you break it apart, maybe now you can, the parts admit skew partitions, right? You're not proving the most general theorem for all perfect graphs, you're just proving a theorem for graphs that don't admit skew partitions, so it's harder to use recursion. And so the kind of heart of the proof of this is to say, if there's a graph with no skew partition, then you can find a two join, so that when you break the graph apart, the parts still don't admit skew partitions. And this is the heart of this. But anyway, I'll talk more about this in more detail tomorrow. But the general question is still open, though recently there's been some progress. All right, so now what I want to do is switch gears and talk about something may or may not be related. It's sort of what one person thinks is related is not necessarily that. If you came to something through something, then you're sure it's very closely related. But in fact, somebody else may say this is a completely different part of the world. And this is also the second talk I'll give tomorrow. I'll talk about this topic in more detail. And this is the topic of chi-boundedness. So what does that mean? So for perfect graphs, we have the property that the click number and the climatic number are exactly the same for all graphs. Now, not for all graphs, for all induced subgraphs. Now, what if I weren't quite so greedy, and I said, I just want to say the climatic number is not much bigger than the click number. I want to bound the climatic number as a function of a click number, of the click number. So, well, first of all, this only makes sense if I'm thinking about an infinite class of graphs, right? Because for one graph, of course I can bound. This is 10 and this is a million. But if I think about infinite classes of graphs, then it makes sense. And to make this a little more easy to work with and a little more elegant, I want to think about hereditary graph classes, which means closed undertaking induced subgraphs. So The graph is in, and now it's in two separate things. So then the hereditary class of graphs is said to be chi-bounded if there's a function. So that for every graph in the class, the chromatic number of this graph is at most f of the Dieck number of this graph. Right? So f depends on the class, but doesn't depend on the individual graph. So for example, perfect graphs are a chi-bounded class, and the function f can be chosen to be identity. All right, so then you start asking which graph classes are chi-bounded. And first naive question is, maybe the class of all graphs is chi-bounded. Okay? Maybe it's always true that the chromatic number is at most 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the Dieck number. And the answer is no. There are many, many proofs why the answer is no, but I'll mention two. So one is called the Michelsky construction. This is not in fact how you spell Michelsky, sorry about that. So what is this? I'm going to construct an infinite family of graphs, so G, G2, G3, and so on. And GK has the property that the Dieck number is 2, so I'm never going to have any triangles. But the chromatic number of GK is K. And that will tell you that this family is not chi-bounded. Right? So here's the construction. This is M2. This is M3. So now how do you get M3 from M2? So you take a copy of M2. Here's this green copy of M2. And then for each of the two vertices of your copy of M2, you make a copy of that vertex. So I want to think of him as being a copy of that. And I want to think of him as being a copy of that. And now his copy will be adjacent to his original neighbors. Meaning this vertex will be adjacent to that. His copy will be adjacent to his original neighbors, meaning this vertex is adjacent to them. So that's the red layer. And now I add yet another new vertex, and I just make it adjacent to the second layer. So this graph, as you all know, has chromatic number 3, and you can see that the Dieck number is 2. So just a quick construction of M4. So the green part of the picture is a copy of M3. Then the red vertices are copies of the vertices of M3. So for example, this is a copy of that. So his neighbors are the original neighbors of this guy, meaning this and that. And then at the end, they add another vertex complete to the red layer. And it's not hard to check that the Dieck number is still 2 and the chromatic number goes up every time we do this. All right, so not the class of all graphs is not chi-bounded. So now you can ask, well, what graph classes are chi-bounded? And one attempt would be, maybe if I forbid any induced subgraph, what I get is a chi-bounded class. But the answer to that is no, because in fact of what we just said, right? If you forbid a triangle, then the Michelsky graphs are still in your class, and yet the chromatic numbers go arbitrarily high. So just forbidding a single graph does not guarantee that what you get is chi-bounded. And in fact, a lot more is true, maybe a lot more is false. The theorem of Werther's, it says, the Michelsky construction gives you a family of graphs where there are no triangles and the chromatic numbers are as big as you want. The theorem of Werther's, it says, in fact, I can construct a family of graphs with no short cycles at all, say no cycles of length at most 100, and chromatic numbers as big as I want, or no cycles of length at most 1,000, and chromatic numbers as big as I want. So that's the theorem. And now a corollary from that is that if I want to forbid a single graph as an induced subgraph, and for the resulting class to be chi-bounded, the graph I forbid cannot have any cycles, right? Because suppose I forbid a graph on 20 vertices, but it has a cycle, so I claim the family I get is not chi-bounded, because in particular graphs with no cycles of lengths at most 21 are in it, and so they don't contain H, because H has a cycle and H has at most 20 vertices, and but I know the chromatic numbers go up arbitrarily high, while the Dieck number is only 2. So this is easy. I think I've turned something on. This corollary is easy if you believe Werther's theorem. But the converse is also conjectured. It's a conjecture of Jefferson in Bentley Sumner that says if a graph has no cycles, then the class of graphs you get by forgiving it as an just subgraph is sky bounded. And that's open, there's some progress. I'm about to describe the progress to you. So I did something bad, or possibly the battery died. So the Jefferson-Sumner conjecture that says if you forbid any graph without cycles, then you get a chi bounded class. So people are, it's hard, but people are working on it. Jefferson himself proved the special case when he conjectured it. He proved that if you forbid a long path, if you forbid any path, you get a chi bounded class. And it's a very nice proof. I'm going to show it to you tomorrow. And then Kirsten and Penrice proved it for in the case when the graph I forbid is a tree of radius of most 2, and then we have some results from slightly more general trees. And then Alex Scott proved something a little different. He proved what we call the topological version of this conjecture. So he proved the following. If you fix a tree or a forest, but now I'm not just going to forbid this forest, I'm going to forbid all its subdivisions, but not in the usual sense, but as an induced subgraph. Right, so I look at a class of graphs that's characterized by the fact that no induced subgraph is a subdivision of my fixed forest. Then this class of graphs is sky-bound. And again, I'll talk some more about it. So there's been quite a bit of activity in this direction recently, so I'll talk some more about it tomorrow. But this is basically all that's known for Jefferson-Sumner conjecture. And let me just briefly tell you about another conjecture that's related and also a nice conjecture, though at the moment the world is kind of stuck in it. There was some activity about this related to this maybe 5 years ago, but maybe it kind of stopped. Both the Jefferson-Sumner conjecture and the Erdős-Reinl conjecture that I'm about to talk about have the property that they say something about forbidding one graph as an induced subgraph. And there's, if you're a graph theorist, you know about excluding minors. And it's clear that excluding a minor tells you something global about the graph, right? Because you can't tell if a graph contains a fixed minor by looking at a small set of vertices. But with induced subgraphs, it's not like that. If I exclude an induced subgraph on 10 vertices, if I exclude a graph on 10 vertices as an induced subgraph, well, I can tell by looking at all tentacles and vertices whether I have it or not. So then the question is not containing a new subgraph, is it a local property of the graph or is it a global property of the graph? Can I say something about the graph if all I know is that the large induced subgraph is excluded? So the Jefferson-Sumner conjecture is kind of in that spirit, right? It says if you exclude a new subgraph, which is a forest, then something good happens. And the Erdős-Reinl conjecture is also like that. So what it says is, I'll refer to the slide in a minute, but what it says is, if I exclude an induced subgraph, then suddenly I get either a very large clique or a very large stable set. A stable set is the same as an independent set. It's a set of vertices with no edges. So for every h, there's a delta, so that if g doesn't contain h as an induced subgraph, then G has a clique or a stable set, which is this big. So the delta depends on H, but doesn't depend on G. Now, why is this surprising? Well, because if I give you a random graph, then that's the size of the biggest clique and biggest stable set that I expect to get. So somehow, forbidding an induced subgraph tells you something interesting. Let me say graph H has the Erdős-Reinl property if this delta of H exists. So the Erdős-Reinl conjecture says every graph has the Erdős-Reinl property. But it's just convenient to be able to refer to it. So let me skip this. It just explains that there's some connection between the Erdős-Reinl conjecture and chi-boundedness, and it's not deep in any way. But let me just tell you what's known about the Erdős-Reinl conjecture. And again, not a lot is known. Somehow it's a little frustrating. So it's known for graphs on at most 4 vertices. The biggest graph of which is known is this graph. It's called the bull. Here is Moody Safra. And then there is an operation that allows you to get infinite families of graphs with the Erdős-Reinl property. And what the operation it's called substitution. So what you do is you start with a graph with the Erlich-Heine property, and now you replace one of its vertices by another graph with the Erlich-Heine property. And what you get is a new graph that still has the Erlich-Heine property. So you can build infinite of graphs with the Erlich-Heine property, but somehow, you know, it was interesting once when Amon Bach and Chudnovsky proved this theorem that I think is very brilliant. But now, okay, we understand that. So now what we want to know is what graphs that cannot be obtained by this operation have the Erlich-Heine property. And then that's wide open. So that's all that's known, just to kind of give you a sense of how terrible the situation is. These are the smallest graphs for which we don't know if they have the Erlich-Heine property. That's C5, the five-edge path, the five-vertex path, the content of the five-vertex path. So let me maybe stop here, but this is the next thing to do. I don't know how to. Thank you.
Are there questions?
Yeah. So for graphs of bounded chi value in, when you exclude one graph, you have to exclude the forest. So what if you exclude the family? So would that give you some nice conjecture?
So there are conjectures about excluding families of cycles. So there are certain sets of lengths, and it's conjectured that if you exclude those, then. Like, for example, if you exclude all odd cycles,
if you exclude all the odd cycles,
yeah,
then the conjecture is...
So it's now a theorem, but it used to be a conjecture. But, I mean, I think a really interesting question is, what families do you need to exclude?
That's right, so right. Necessary families.
Yeah,
not
yeah.
Just,
right. So I mean, in fact, Paul Seymour and I think it's just the two of us, have a related theorem. So if you exclude the finite family, then it has to have certain properties. But we can't prove the converse.
Another question? Okay, let's thank the speaker one more time.